Hello everyone. Welcome to another edition of Martech Brain, a NetCore initiative. Today, we have Kedar Parekh. Kedar has been with NetCore for many years. He heads product management and machine learning at NetCore, and he's been instrumental in terms of defining and getting our Smartech platform built. Welcome to Martech Brain, Kedar.
Thanks, Rajesh. Thanks a lot for having me on this podcast.
So we are recording this on the last day of 2020, our most amazing year from many different ways. So what are your thoughts on the year that has just gone by?
It's actually very interesting to have it record on the last day. I didn't realize it was 31st when we agreed, but I think that's a great day to record this. The year has been really sort of a year of ups and downs for almost everyone in the world, not just us. But keeping the context to, let's say, Martech, I think it has been a really exciting year. This year is where we, at least talking about India specifically, if we were to say, has been sort of an inflection point, like it was in China for e-commerce, right? Because of the pandemic, a lot of data is now getting generated because of natural movement towards the online. The shift towards, let's say, people who used to actually buy groceries. Everyone has shifted buying groceries online. And I think that is one key point. When people start buying groceries, that's a more habit-forming thing because you do it more often. And naturally, then you tend to be comfortable of buying things without the manual touch and feel of it. So a great year, I think there has been a lot of push towards the online. Naturally generates a lot of data. And overall, data is what AI and ML thrives on. So overall, from a data AI perspective, great year, I would say. Of course, there has been a lot of hardships. People have lost jobs. Businesses have shut down. Can't ignore those consequences, of course.
Absolutely. I think it's a year. I remember in January, I was in the US. I came back end of the month. And then we had our company offsite. Right. And we were made big plans for the year. And then March, the pandemic hits. A lot of those plans for all of us go awry. And then you have to sort of fight back. It also brings in the resilience of companies. And for us, of course, being in the digital space, growth finally has kicked back in.
I know. We were hit really hard in Q1, but gradually growth has sort of returned back. Similarly, talking about, let's say, AI/ML, there has been an interesting challenge there as well. So a lot of machine learning models, right? So this is like Nassim says, Black Swan event. Of sorts, right? So a lot of ML and AI models haven't seen something like this happening ever, right? So all those models, as long as they are not relearning on their own, need to be thrown out of the window. And you need to retrain your machine learning models. So even for AI and ML, it has been a really year of turmoil, so to say.
Absolutely. And I was reading somewhere that essentially if the 2010s, were about SaaS, you know, software as a service, the 2020s are going to be about data, right? The decade of data. Right. And I think that's really the focus that we have in our conversation today. Right. The topic you have chosen for discussion is AI marketing trends 2021. And we are going to dig deeper into that.
Sure.
And before we get to the actual trends, which are there in 2021, I think you have a very interesting data value flywheel. Right. Would you like us to share that with us? And would you like to run us through that?
Sure, Rajesh. I think it's a very simple one, but yet very important. Let me just bring that up. Yeah. I'm assuming this is visible.
Yes, yes.
Right. So essentially, the flywheel goes this way. That first and foremost of anything is capturing good amount of data, right? Right amount of data, data in its proper sanity, and you sort of clean it, transform it. And it's important to capture data so as to derive information out of it, right? Data by itself holds no value, honestly. It is actually the information that's stored in the data that brings in value. And talking about, let's say, product management or marketing, these are some four broad buckets of data that I classify in. It's actually engagement data, behavior data, engagement data could be engagement on any of your marketing channels, email, SMS, who's clicking on what sort of notifications, which sort of notifications resonate with what cohorts. So it's that behavioral data on your app, website, in-store, transaction data is actually the gold mine. And finally, demographic data, whatever you can collect during signups. In fact, I'll talk about this more. You could infer a lot of demographics, right? But I'll touch upon that later. So the most important step is to collect data and be able to turn that into information, right? And once you have that, the next logical thing is you bring in your Tableau, Power BI, you bring in your data analyst who can then pull out insights from this data, right? And which is where certain insights could be, hey, my app DAUs were down 10% last week, right? Why did that happen? Or let's say my revenue is seeing a spike yesterday, right? There has to be something very particular about it. So these are insights, but the insights themselves are not sufficient enough, which is where you need to sort of dig deep to understand this phenomena, right? Like I said, if my app DAUs are down 10%, I would want to understand why that has happened. Often the why part of it is where a lot of intelligence comes in, right? It's not easy to understand why certain things happen. Now me predicting a cohort of, let's say, 5,000 users who are likely to churn next is great, and a brand can act on it and try and run a, let's say, retention campaign on it, or try and incentivize them for an app install or a transaction. But if I tell the brand why they are going to churn out, it's going to be even more valuable.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Rajesh, I equate it to the saying, right? You can give a man a fish, or you can teach him to fish. Mm-hmm. It's similar to that. So me telling you a cohort of 5,000 users likely to churn is great. But if I tell you why they are going to churn, the value is much better, because those learnings can be applied to your product. And you could not only arrest these users, but also future users in subsequent cohorts. So answering the why is often important. And no matter what tool or, let's say, what data science team or analyst team you have, you should always aspire to turn your insights into intelligence. That's the next step. And there is one more interesting point there. The way people do this is doing correlation analysis often, right? And at times it is a little flawed. For instance, there is a very popular case study saying the sale of ice cream and forest fire are peaking at the same time, right? Does not mean whenever ice cream sells higher, forest fires are caused. There is a strong correlation, but there is no causation. So in your analysis of why things happened, you should not just look at correlation, right? You should also look at what is causing that. So are your product problems causing your users to churn, right? Don't just find correlation, try and find causation looking at user flows on your website or or your app. And that's where I think AI can come in. AI can look at infinite number of time series data points, try and find correlation, try and find causation between them, and surface some of these insights. And finally, once you have these intelligence, all that it enables is to make you better decisions on your campaigns, on your user journeys, retargeting campaigns, optimization, personalization, and ultimately better decision help you again generate better data, which is what I call as data flywheel. It's no rocket science, but each step of this flywheel can be sort of looked as a funnel, and you could try and optimize at every single step, and AI can add value at every single step, right? As a marketer, the time it takes from a data to an insight and decision could be really long, but with AI and automation and all the advancements in computing power, some of these things could be done in hours or even minutes.
I think it's a fantastic framework, going from data to insights to intelligence to decision making, and then getting back into data. So it's a flywheel which basically really accelerates with the rise in data, with the increase in data that you're collecting. And I think we've seen an incredible growth now because of digitization in the data that's now available to businesses and brands. for their decision making. Of course, they can't do it all just through simple rule-based systems. You need machine learning to essentially automatically pick up the trends and give predictions what's going to happen, which I think gives us a very good foundation to talk about the actual trends. What do you see in the world of AI marketing, AI-led marketing in 2021? So what is the first trend, Kedar?
First one would be, like I spoke about, I'm a big fan of insights. In fact, it's probably like everyone has been a kid. Some people thought of growing up being a pilot. Maybe somewhere there was a detective in me. So I was always driven towards finding insights from data. That's the child detective still living inside me. So first trend that I see for next year is around insights, and I call it automated insights. And we have started seeing some of the developments already coming in. For instance, Google Analytics 4 has this section called as Intelligent Insights. And essentially what Google does is looks through your data and surfaces some of these insights for you, right? So in my data flywheel, I spoke about turning data into insights. You often need an analyst there. Or if you are equipped enough to take your hands on Power BI or Tableau, you could surface them on your own. But the trend clearly is products that not only give you dashboards, but also surface insights for you. Right, and it's easily possible looking at some of the time series data points. The first generation of the tool started by simple outlier analysis, right? So if there is a 15-day average being breached, right, you capture that and you surface that as an insight. Most of the insight, I would say 60% of the insights can be easily driven by an outlier detection, right? Any outlier is an insight. Your revenue peaking or dropping is an insight by itself. So the trend that I see in next generation analytics and marketing tools is some of these tools will start surfacing insights on their own, and not just by outlier detection, but applying these AIML models that go deeper and find correlation and causation also, and try and tell you why certain insights are so, or what is the root cause behind that. I think that's a clear trend. Even at Smarttech, we sort of have heavily invested in surfacing some of these insights on the dashboard. The whole idea is there is someone looking at your data 24/7 and is at an occurrence of an event is gonna ping you back, drawing your attention to the things that need your attention.
And of course, that someone that you mentioned in the case of Smarttech is Raman.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is doing that. Great. So automated insights, I think, is the first big trend. So as you're getting a lot of data, you are able to then figure out the patterns that are there, and someone's telling you, in this case, of course, a machine learning algorithm is really telling you in an automatic manner what's happening. What's the second trend?
The second trend, I would say, is bigger one and more important, and it is not just going to be a 2021 trend, but I see this now getting started. I call it the augmented marketer. Some part of that definition is also possibly borrowed by Gartner. Gartner also calls it maybe or augmented marketer, or let's say a citizen data scientist. But the whole thought behind that is people often sort of discuss saying AI versus marketer, right? Is AI going to replace the marketer, or is AI going to compete with the marketer in some way? I think the right way to look at it is not AI versus marketer, but it is going to be an augmented marketer versus the standard traditional marketer who refuses to change, for instance, or refuses to adapt new techniques. It's going to be that. And when I say augmented marketer, it is basically the emergence of a marketer who is more data literate, willing to get his hands dirty with the tool, is able to also quickly consume what the tool is throwing at him. And that could be those automated insights. And there are a bunch of things these AI tools today are able to do for a marketer. The first one could be, let's say, identifying the right audience for a campaign. And AI could do it beautifully. In fact, just to maybe bring the point across really well, I would say we have all accepted recommender systems, right, as a norm. And thanks to Amazon and Netflix, we all know product recommendation engines are sort of becoming a norm. It's no longer a trend, right? So what these systems do is recommend a product to a user, right? You could actually flip this around and say, while I can recommend a product to a user, if I have a campaign around a product, I could actually recommend the right users for that campaign, right? And I clearly see that one place where AI can easily add a lot of value, but today a very few marketers would be doing that, right? They depend on their either intuition or manual segmentation. I'm not saying that those are great ways, but the time it takes to possibly carve out a right segment, and there is always possibility of missing out for a few more users who would have ideally been part of that segment.
So in a way, what you're saying is leading from the insights.
Right.
So the insights are there. Now you want to act on those insights. So the action insights become actionable.
Right.
The systems will essentially start recommending to marketers, okay, that today this is the campaign that you should run. These are the users you should be sending this campaign to. So in a way, making the job of the marketer that much simpler.
Right.
Because of this. And that's what you really mean by the augmented marketer, where the system, the machines, machine learning is helping the marketer do his or her job that much more effectively.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Similarly, once let's say you have an audience identified for a campaign, right? The machines could go even further, and some of the intelligent systems do go today. For instance, what a marketer would do is run an A/B test. Or let's say if you are really adventurous and a little more inclined, you would do a multivariate test.
Mm-hmm.
Essentially, what you are trying to do is change few combinations of, let's say, subject line, title, color, some variables that you could change, permutation and combinations of those. See which one is working best on a sample set. And then the entire janta gets the winning combination, right? Now, this is a one-time optimization. Imagine machines who could optimize a campaign in real time throughout the day or throughout the week or throughout the year, whatever the tenure of campaign is, right? Why adapt to a winning combination and then stay with it? Dynamics change, weather changes, basically events in the industry change, right? You could have a Sunday on a previous day and a Monday on the next day. Both days are completely different. Why do you stick to one winning campaign? Combination. So self-optimizing campaigns could be a very good option where marketer can let go of the control of optimization part to an AI. That's what, again, I call as augmented marketer.
Right. And of course, there's also a big role it can play on the text and creative generation.
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, this has been an year where algorithms like GPT-3 came out, and we all know what amazing combinations or what amazing possibilities it has sort of put in front of us. In fact, VW did a campaign where they openly sort of invited best of the content writers, and they were sort of put against the GPT-3 and did a test, and we all know who won. No brownie points for guessing that.
Absolutely. So we have the two big trends, automated insights, the augmented marketer. Okay. And what's the third big trend that you see for 2021?
Yeah. So third one, I would say, would be explainable AI, right? And by that, what I mean is basically this year, the concerns around data privacy and the amount of data that you could collect and process will definitely increase. There is no way it is going to go down, right? And with lesser data, if an AI comes up with some recommendation that seems like more like a magic, right? It is not going to fly. For explainable, basically, it's hard to trust for any marketer. It's hard to trust a machine recommendation if he fully does not understand the logic behind it, right? In order to trust someone, you should understand why those recommendations are coming, right? What is the calculations or what are the equations at work behind those recommendations? And which is where explainable AI comes in. Basically, it will provide reasons, explanations, model accuracy figures, expected outcome for a particular messaging campaign or an offer or a recommendation that it throws out. And not only that, it will also give you the reasoning behind it so that the marketer is able to trust those recommendations and then be comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, taking this a step further, possibly not in 2021, but I think we have been also discussing running simulations, right? So that could be an extension to explainable AI, where a marketer can run simulations and see what could be the outcome of some of the experiments he wants to run. I see that clearly being a trend. Bringing in trust in AI is very important for the marketer to let go of some things that he was so used to do it manually.
So what you're really saying is that if I'm, say, a marketer and the engine is throwing up some insights, right, and recommendations on a page, I could, in a way, double click on an insight and actually dig deep into saying, why is this particular product being recommended to this person?
Absolutely.
By doing that, as a marketer, I get more confidence. So it's not just something being picked out of a hat, as it were.
Right.
But there is a logic,
right,
based on the person's previous actions, based on maybe the cohort that that person falls into,
right,
and so on. So that there's a logic, and that's what you're making more transparent,
right,
to people.
Absolutely. Which is again tying back to the data flywheel, where I said it is often important to explain the why behind certain, right, things, not just to help you solve product problems, but like in this case, give you more confidence behind those prescriptive suggestions that the algorithm has given.
Excellent point. Okay, so which is the fourth trend that you're seeing?
Honestly, the fourth one, I would possibly not call it as a trend, but I'm somewhere hoping and also seeing some optimism around that. I call it doing more with less. And this, I sort of, I'm borrowing it from the ad tech ecosystem, right? Traditionally, all the ad tech algorithms have never been having access to first party data in most cases, right? What they actually do is pick up breadcrumbs as a user jumps from one website to another, leaving some behavioral traits behind, right? And these algorithms sort of pick up those traits and then generate data points out of it. A couple of simple examples. Let's say anyone who is going to an educational institute, right, every day, and sorry, it's not relevant today because everybody's, let's say, working out of home. But in general, right, if you go to an educational institute, 97% probability that you are a student, barring 3% the staff, right? And an algorithm that's 97% accurate is good enough as long as you're not in banks or financial institution. Similar, other, let's say another data point could be based on behavior, right? If you're continuously looking at women's garments, it's very likely that you are actually a female, right? In fact, Rajesh, a very interesting experiment that we did and we intend to sort of put it to good use,
mm-hmm,
is finding gender from email ID. And you will be surprised the accuracy that we came up with, just looking at your email ID and predicting gender, is 82%.
Wow, that's fantastic.
In fact, there are many people who also add their birth year to an email ID, right? And you could possibly, with some degree of accuracy, try and predict the birth year. So that's the trend I wanted to say, doing more with less. Traditionally, first party systems like marketing automation or CDP, they used to depend on anything and everything that the that the user has willingly provided. But there is a lot you could infer without the user even providing it. And which is what I call as doing more with less. And CDPs at least have started doing this by bringing in, let's say, probabilistic identity resolution or trying to bring in some derived attributes. And a derived attribute could be, let's say, gender. Right, it could be inferred from your behavior or your email ID or tons of other signals.
So it's actually fascinating. I mean, if you're a young student listening to this, you're a student or a marketer in your early years, I think the couple of skill sets which would be very useful to start building on if you've not already done so are getting a deeper understanding on machine learning. There are some excellent courses out there. And I think also the understanding of statistics, I think, becomes very important. What you're bringing in, Kedar, is the point that it doesn't have to be a zero or one. Okay, you can use probability theory, get a reasonably good approximation.
Right.
Even though the users, the customers may not have directly told you that data or given you that information directly.
Absolutely. In fact, there is a funny case study. It's quite popular. And maybe the users could Google it if they are not aware. Where Target was able to figure out a teen girl was actually pregnant even before her father knew. Right? Just based on what she has been shopping and looking around in the store.
Yeah, I think Charles Duhigg has written about this story in his book, The Power of Habit.
Yeah.
It's right. There, absolutely. Which of course reminds me, I've been telling people, Amazon's been showing me in their right top page,
I know,
interested in maternity products.
Yeah, so, I don't know what's wrong with that.
You know, I was thinking about this and I said that, I think what brands like Amazon and Netflix, of course, they are the cutting edge. I think what they also need to see is not just what we click on, but also what we don't click on.
Right.
I mean, I look at some of the Netflix recommendations and I get the same sort of universe,
right, okay,
because of what I've watched. Now, I've made decisions that, look, these are the things I've probably seen 50 times,
right,
as in the placement on the screen, and I'm not interested in that. But
absolutely,
there is no easy way for me to tell Netflix back that, look, don't keep showing me these movies or these web series. I'm not interested. So a lot of times, of course, because it matches with what I have seen,
right,
but it's not something I'm interested in.
And I think the negative feedback point, Rajesh, is absolutely valid, and which is where many recommender systems sort of miss out on, saying, hey, this user did click on this, but are you taking into account, I have shown this product to him twice and he did not click. Right, that negative feedback is very important. In fact, that's one of the sort of core ISPs which sort of differentiates our recommender engine in-house from some of the others. Very great, valid point.
Great. So I think we've covered these four big trends that we are seeing in AI marketing in 2021. Just to run through again, automated insights, the augmented marketer, explainable AI, you know, where you get more details on the actual decisions the machine is making. And finally, I think a great point that Kedar brought up is the idea of inferences, doing more with less.
Right.
And I think once you start putting these four things together, okay, you get that sort of data flywheel that Kedar, you spoke about early days. And that's, I think, the real power. Everyone else may have the same products, may get the same shipping. Okay, but it's a step in the direction of omni-channel personalization. You're creating greater, better experiences for your customers, getting them to the products they want to buy,
right,
which they may not even know about that much faster.
Right. And actually helping them in the overall process, right?
Absolutely. So lots to look forward to in 2021. I think some amazing trends which have begun, of course, which have been there for many years, but all coming together very nicely with the explosion in the availability of data for,
right,
for businesses. So as we move to the last segment, Kedar, it's our five ones.
Sure.
So quick, short answers on what you think are these five things which I'm going to ask you. So first question is, one future tech or trend that excites you?
It has to be on-device ML, on-device machine learning. And it's really fascinating, at least for me, and I'm sure for a lot of people. Basically, there is this phrase, right? What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, right? Similarly, Apple is doing this with their mobile phones, saying what happens on device stays on device. And that's great because there are certain advantages. It's obviously, if you are able to do predictions on mobile, it's low latency. It does not need network. It does not invade your privacy because whatever is being captured is being utilized and disposed of on the device itself. So I'm very kicked about this. I see Google also opening up APIs on MLKit, and with the amount of GPU processing that you these days find on devices, I'm absolutely bullish on this one trend of doing machine learning on device.
Yeah, I think we all used to wonder what will all the horsepower that's there, computing power that's there on devices will get used for. And in there you have.
Right.
Okay, that's great. One tech or trend that has disappointed you.
Okay, it has to be chatbots, if you ask me. And while people may agree or disagree, we have seen some of the great implementations like showers in 2016. And looking back at last 4 and 5 years where we have come, right? While there are good chatbots in the academics and everywhere, what we interact with on a day-to-day basis and without, let's say, taking the names of banks, right? What we see is simple rule-based dumb bots, honestly, if you ask me. Chatbots have real potential to revolutionize many things, not just customer service, but maybe preventing people from getting into depression, suicide, healthcare. I see immense potential in that, but I'm a little disappointed looking at what we have achieved in last 4 and 5 years.
No, you're absolutely right. In fact, my son was just complaining to me today morning. He went to a site, this chatbot pops up, asks him his name, and he says, I don't want to tell you my name. And for the rest of the conversation, it is, dear, I don't want to tell you my name.
Oh.
And he's telling me, Papa, these problems should have been solved by now, right?
Right. This is amazing.
Okay. One good book recommendation for people.
Yeah, I would say Fooled by Randomness. It's not a new one. In fact, it's first one in the series. Pretty old book. At least a decade old, if not more. Fooled by Randomness by Nassim Taleb.
Yeah, and I think it's a great book, of course. And anyone who gets started with that, I think they should look at the other books in the series also that Taleb has written. And I think another book that you had mentioned to me some time ago is on product-led growth.
Right.
And that's another book. Absolutely.
It's a very easy read, probably not even 100 pages, and great book by Bushwes for anyone who is in product management, marketing, or even growth. It's a phenomenal book.
Great. One good person podcast to follow?
Podcast, I would say Data Skeptic. It's a great podcast, covers a lot of tutorials, interviews around statistics, machine learning, talks to great personas in the industry. Becomes a little technical at times, but really a great podcast. If I were to talk about one great person to follow, I absolutely love following Simon Sinek. His leadership lessons are all bite-sized, simple, no jargon, and easy to relate and adapt.
Oh, absolutely. And finally, last question, one key driving belief in your life.
I would say if you want something bad enough, you will find a way. Right? That's simple, my driving belief. And that applies to almost everything. Right? In fact, it also funnily applies to my wife, right? I loved her so much. I persuaded her to get married to me.
Fantastic story.
She's also a ex-Net Korean.
Absolutely.
Right. And this applies to everyone yes. From your career choice to your life goals to things that you want to achieve in life, be it weight loss, right? If you want it bad enough, you will always find a way. Else you will just find excuses.
Yeah, there is this song, of course, that the whole kainat comes to help you. I think
absolutely, the Shah Rukh thing.
Yes,
very true.
And it's a story also echoed in it's a theme
the secret.
Also echoed in The Secret and The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. So many people have talked about it, but I think it's easy to learn it. It's very difficult to sort of practice it.
Right.
I think you're doing it and you've done it. That's great. So thanks a lot, Kedar. That was a wonderful conversation. I think very, very good inputs from Kedar on the data flywheel and really the dramatic innovations that we are seeing led by data and by machine learning that we can expect in the coming year and years to come. Thank you for watching. Thank you very much, Kedar. That was MarTech Brain, NetCore Initiative. We'll be back soon with yet another episode. Stay tuned.